science fiction sequel 2010, and it is no easy task picking up 9 years later the story of Stanley Kubrick's magnificent science fiction epic 2001, A Space Odyssey, with its prehistoric apes discovering weaponry and with its mysterious black monolith appearing out of nowhere every time mankind was about to make some great leap forward in knowledge. 2001 left off with trouble aboard a U.S. space mission to the moons of Jupiter, and 2010 picks up with a joint U.S. and Russian mission to the same place as a nervous astronaut and a nervous cosmonaut attempt to board the old Discovery spacecraft from the original film, which is still out there in orbit.
How's this pulse?
It is high. Not to worry too much.
Hey, do you speak any Russian?
No.
That's okay. I speak English real.
I'm fogging up.
Hey, here now. Have you heard the one about the marathon runner and the chicken?
Don't patronize me. I'm getting nauseous.
If he bangs, he will choke. Don't close your eyes. Look at the middle of Discovery. The middle, not the ends. Look at the part where it's moving the least. Don't take your eyes off it.
I'm not gonna throw up. I'm an engineer, goddamn. Maybe you better patronize me a little. What about the marathon runner?
I made it up.
Oh. I'm looking amidship now.
You see any lights?
No, no lights.
70 meters.
You're almost there. How's that for patronizing?
Not bad.
Now that sums up the movie for me, that scene. Good looking, to be sure, but not really tension-filled because you know they got to get to that ship or we're not going to have any kind of a movie. Now, later in the film, the American commander, played by Roy Scheider, attempts to investigate at much closer range what's going on the moons of Jupiter, but the human-like computer on board the Discovery, the HAL 9000 computer, for its own reasons, wants to talk everyone out of sending an investigative probe down to the moons of Jupiter.
Dr. Chandra, I'm ready to stop the countdown if you want.
No, Hal, don't stop.
I am fully confident in your ability to study the phenomenon by yourself. I have complete faith in you.
Propellant tank pressurization completed. Voltage steady. Are you sure you are making the right decision? I think we should stop. 4 minutes to ignition. I enjoy working with human beings and have stimulating relationships with you.
We enjoy working with you, Hal, and we will continue to do so even if we are separated by great distance.
Good God. Color. It's fading.
It seems to be losing its chemical strength.
I think we should stop the countdown, Dr. Chandra.
No. Don't do that.
This behavior is inconsistent with logic, Dr. Chandra. This phenomenon is too important to leave unless it represented danger. Do you think there is danger here?
I love that character, HAL 9000. I just wish we had seen him sooner in the picture. Now, the original 2001 dealt with great issues in a poetic way, with symbols that required us to fill in some blanks. And there are a lot of people to this day who still haven't been able to fill in the blanks. This new film is much more explicit about its meaning, which turns out to be a warning that the superpowers on Earth had better cooperate or we're going to lose everything. You see, while these scientists are out there in space back on Earth, there's a world war brewing between the United States and Russia in South America. Now, you can't, of course, argue with the peace message of 2010, but you can argue with the way it's presented, which is very slowly and repeatedly. I have no idea how young moviegoers who have never seen the original 2001 will react to this movie, but this fan of that film wishes that there had been more of the monolith than of the HAL 9000 computer sooner in this film, and then I would like maybe to have seen it take off into a solitary journey by Roy Scheider into space. As it now plays, 2010 is just a good-looking half-hour episode of Star Trek or The Twilight Zone stretched out to 2 hours.
I think you're being way, way, way too hard on this movie in the continuum of current science fiction films. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm going to start by saying there will never be another movie like 2001. Mm-hmm. It's one of the greatest movies ever made. Let's put it on the shelf. I would like to look at this movie more in terms of the tradition of Star Wars, Star Trek, and the movies like that that have come out more recently. And it's a superior example of that genre. It's got really fabulous outer space special effects. It's got a really thrilling adventure as they're going toward the Discovery. I love that scene that you didn't like where the guy gets the attack of panic and disorientation as he's in outer
space. I thought they were
also
making jokes in that scene that I didn't think if they were really having panic. I think they were trying to play it both ways.
Oh,
also
I think it really
we saw a shortened version of that scene. I think it plays for about 5 minutes, and I was
and
saying,
really,
come on, let's get to the ship. We gotta go.
I wasn't saying so. What do you mean? You said, we know they have to get to the ship so there's no suspense. How do you know that? And what do you know? How do you know what's going to be on board the Discovery?
You know what's going to be on board the Discovery? HAL 9000.
What a clever guy.
And so that means I know they have to get there because we're going to find the most interesting character.
In that case, you know everything about every movie because you know what has to happen, so you can't be interested in the process.
No.
The sight of Jupiter beneath them, of the moons, of outer space, the hardware, is extremely fascinating.
I said it. Good looking. Real good looking. Slow. A little bit predictable.
No, I disagree.
And the finish of the film.
The one thing I will agree with you is on the finish. It's really disappointing. All the expectations that we have from the first movie, and in this movie they keep saying something wonderful is going
to
happen.
That's right.
And what happens basically is that the aliens come on cable TV with this morning's big message for peace on Earth.
Well, yeah.
So that the last 10 minutes of the movie are totally disappointing. But as an entertainment, as a Christmas science fiction picture, as something to go see, it's a lot of fun, and I like it.
Yeah, but you're saying you're really laying it in a lower grade level. I'm saying, hey, they shot for the moon, so to speak, and then they didn't quite make it, and it took a long time to get
it's a heck of a lot better than a half an hour of Twilight Zone. You've got to admit
that. I love Twilight Zone.